Our next panel shines a spotlight on the nation's most influential women in the pursuit of justice. From formidable police officers to groundbreaking judges, their leadership is now reshaping the very fabric of our justice system. Their innovative approaches and tireless advocacy are reshaping systems to better protect and support women, while their leadership is fostering a more inclusive and equitable society. What are the big efforts that need to be made to make our society and systems safe and secure? And that's why our next panel will be taking you through just that. Ladies, please welcome Justice Indu Malhotra, retired judge from the Supreme Court and senior counsel, Supreme Court of India, Suman Nalwa, who's the DCP and PRO Delhi Police, and Saheli Chakrabarty, who's the assistant professor of National University of Juridical Sciences, in conversation with Shweta Punj, deputy editor, Money Control. Shweta, the stage is all yours.
It's been a fantastic and a very uplifting day today. But our last conversation with the star cast of Delhi Crime has set the stage for what we're going to discuss now. Can I begin with a show of hands of women who have felt very vulnerable while taking a cab at night? Can I get a show of hands? Can I get a show of hands if you felt scared walking up to your parking lot in your office, building, society, when it's dark outside or when it's completely quiet? That's an overwhelming number. This session, where we are talking about safety, society and systems, how did we get to this point where an overwhelming number of women present in this room and in this country continue to feel and live out of fear? As we speak today, as we gather here today, there are thousands of doctors protesting in Kolkata against a brutal crime that happened with a doctor in a space that was supposed to be her safe space, in a hospital where she went to work every day. The protests are going on, and we are hoping that this will be a point of inflection for us. This brutality has broken our spirit in some ways, but I think it's also strengthened our resolve to keep the conversation going until there is a real change on ground. And I have with me to discuss what can be done, where do we go from here, three trailblazers, forces of nature: Justice Indu Malhotra, Suman Alva, and Saheli Chakrabarty. A big welcome. Thank you very much. Justice Malhotra, I'd like to begin by asking you. Every day in the news, we read about the brutality of crimes against women. And this is not a new phenomenon. It's been happening. It's been happening in India. It's been happening across the world. Why? Is there a reason? Is there one reason? Are there five reasons? I mean, why is it that every crime seems to get more and more brutal than the last one? And where are we going wrong, you know, as a society, as law enforcers, that has made us reach this point?
Well, it's like this, that these incidents do keep taking place from time to time. The first point is that today there's more reporting than there was earlier. Each time an incident takes place, a commission of inquiry is instituted. There are enough laws which have now been framed, and there are enough policy guidelines. Where I feel that the whole system has broken down is at the level of implementation of the existing laws. I think the issue which concerns me, after you watch, you know, the media reports, etc., with respect to the RG Carr case, is that preventive steps ought to be taken. The doctors being subjected to inhuman hours of duty, 36 hours at a time, is the first aspect. Secondly, complete lack of security. There is no security whatsoever apparently in the hospital. The ingress, egress is completely uncontrolled. Third, no separate resting places for doctors and various infrastructural inadequacies which are there in the system, and these are government hospitals which get government funds. And one of my biggest disappointments is that even after the Nirbhaya case took place, there was a huge fund which was collected of 7,500 crores. Not even a fraction of it seems to have been spent on improving the safety and security of women, of course in the medical profession and other professions also, to safeguard their protection. And that is where I feel the system is lacking, the lack of prioritization in disbursement of funds which are meant for this purpose.
Right. So Anji, let me bring you in here. There was an entire series that was planned around Delhi crime, and you have the job of taking care of Delhi's safety and security. It's a city that is constantly in the news for not very good reasons. What are the challenges that you face as someone who's on the ground implementing laws, implementing policies, keeping law and order under check? Why are we here today? Where is the breakdown, the systemic issue that you see here?
Shweta, I would like to say that when you talked about why, I would like to say that in addition to all the socio-cultural, issues that are there, which are disempowering to women, I see the fact that we have so many women here today, and we are celebrating Shri Shakti. That itself is an indicator that women are aspiring to be more than what they had ever been. They don't want to be contained. But I was doing some research, and I came across that there is a backlash to this development, where women are coming forward. There is not a field left where they are not there. Now they are coming into the leadership roles. Earlier they were into lower scales, middle management. Now they are into leadership roles. So there is a backlash. If you see the internet, it is filled with violence against women in the form of incels and manosphere. And these are getting unchecked. People are writing any filth they want to write. And since they are getting in check, nothing is happening to them. So that violence which you see on the social media is reflecting at the ground also. So that is, I believe, the reason that we see increase in crime against women. Women are again aspiring, so they are migrating. They are going to different places for their work, for their education. They are wanting to express their creativity, their true potential. So they become especially vulnerable at that point.
So patriarchal mindsets.
Exactly.
That what you're referring
it's a patriarchal
to?
Mindset. And since now they are migrating, they are revolting against this patriarchal mindset, they are becoming more vulnerable when they go there, where there is no support structure. We have wonderful landmark judgments and legislation. I think it's one of the best in the world. And there are a lot of good policies also, like we have reservation for women in the police. We are wanting that 33% of Delhi police should be of women, so that we are more visible out there to instill confidence in women that we are there for you as an organization.
Right.
But still, there is a lot that has to be done vis-a-vis institutional framework. Why do we have incidents happening in the hospitals, in the organizations? Is it not the responsibility of that institution to ensure how they are treating their women employees? What are the protocols they have set up? How welcoming they are to the women? Whether they are transparent enough? What is the culture of that organization? Is it a culture of silence? Do we sweep it under the carpet? But I believe more and more organizations, as we rise in the leadership positions,
right,
we will be opening up, we will be owning up that these are happening and we can change it, that will be a welcome step.
Right. Saheli, let me bring you in here. You know, when it comes to sensitization and information that women should be aware of their rights at the workplace, what does your research say about that? Because there is a posh law, but we've seen continuous increase in crimes at the workplace. So the correlation seems to be completely, there's a law should have actually deterred the whole increase in the crime rate, but that's not happened.
Firstly, thank you to the organizers for putting up such a colossal stage where women like us can discuss, deliberate, and probably question the issues that are very fervently spoken about. And safety of women at workplace is definitely one of the pertinent one. You asked about the POSH Act, which is mostly spoken about or claimed to be not gender neutral, which it is not. And one of the shield that is said to be of women. Let me ask a most important, pertinent question here. For centuries, our social reformers have shed their blood and have fought the battle for us women to be included in this work field. Is it for the day today that we will be discussing about the safety? For us to be included in the workspace, our violation of safety, is it the price that we are ought to pay? If a company is expecting us to shed 12 or 10 hours a day, are we not expecting a safety space or a restroom?
So what's the awareness level when it comes to...
Yes, so I'll share one small story with you as part of my academic endeavor. We led to seeing what the efficacy of POSH is amongst the domestic workers in parts of Calcutta. Now, platform like this will not speak about domestic workers because we are only interested, or probably so to say, about the ones who's aware of the law. To your horrific surprise, Shweta, 90% of the women who are employed as domestic workers do not even know that a POSH law exists. To them, rape and sexual harassment is synonymous. And so to say, as per them, they do not even know that LCC, for that matter, Local Complaint Committee, exists. If I come to the corporate ladder where women are working hard day in, day out, they are shunned with the fear that their jobs may be terminated if they go and complain against their boss or employer.
So breaking that perception, Justice Malhotra, is the tough part, right? We have an act, we have a legislative framework, but if you look at an industry-wise breakdown, and like you were sharing with me, we've seen a lot more complaints specifically from three sectors: sports, films, Bollywood, and the third one was, I'm sorry, armed forces, right? So let's talk about, are there any specific industries where we see better reporting, or do we see, greater violations, and that's why they're being spoken about and discussed?
Well, recently there have been cases which have come from the sports federations, that is from the film industry, and a recent complaint by an Air Force officer which was with respect to her seniors. Now, what I think the common thread which runs through all these three cases is complete lack of implementation of the POSH in all these three areas. In the sports federation, there was no internal complaints committee which was constituted, and that is what made the National Human Rights Commission issue suo motu notice to all the sports federations, and it was found that in 15 national federations there was no internal complaints committee functioning, or even if there was, it was dysfunctional, there was no external member, so there was no redressal mechanism. Similarly, there have been complaints, women have become more vocal, it is in the film industry. And the third, which I find the most disheartening, is in the armed forces, because the entire system is opaque, it's hierarchical, and there is no manner of redressal. In fact, the Supreme Court judgments don't seem to be being made applicable to armed forces. If any officer has a problem, there is no way where she can make a complaint, and if she makes a complaint, she really has to suffer for it. There are innumerable cases which are now coming to light where retired male officers have written that if a woman made a complaint, her promotion would go, she would be ostracized by the male officers, and they all have to still continue to work from the same base. So the underlying thread is that there has been a complete lack of implementation of the laws at the ground level.
So let me just interject here. You know, so how do we take this narrative forward? We have an act, implementation has been poor. I don't want to pick on industries, but these three industries probably are reflective of what's happening across workplaces, right? So what are the solutions? Now we have what's happening in Kolkata. I wanted to get a specific point from you on that. You know, what are your recommendations on this very complicated case now? And then, how do we take this narrative forward? What are the solutions for this? If the implementation is poor, what kind of checks and balances can we put in place?
So I think it would have to be industry specific. And of course, at the overall level, I think the Ministry of Women Empowerment and Child Development, I think they should take a more proactive role. At least if there are, for instance, the National Sports Federations, at least they must ensure that there are, the redressal mechanism is operational. Someone has to do that. Even those sports, law and order, and hospitals are all state subjects. But at the overall arching level, maybe the Ministry of Women and Child Development must take a more proactive role to ensure at least the redressal mechanism is functioning. And insofar as the armed forces are concerned, I do believe that there should be, in fact, they have done it in the United States and even now recently in the UK, where they have constituted committees with an external member so that there is greater scrutiny in sexual harassment cases being tried. Otherwise, internal mechanisms don't work.
Right.
There has to be an external member to ensure it's a fair system of redressal.
Okay, I'm afraid we've run out of time, but let me quickly get in, Ms. Suman Alva, also on this. Your one solution on the rising crime rate in Delhi. What's the one thing that Delhi police can do to make all of us feel safer?
We have recently, after this Calcutta thing, a lot of reporters, they approached me what Delhi police is doing. So I told them we have already done whatever needed to be done right after Nibhaya. We, of course, had the reservation policy put in place where we have more women in the force. There is one round the clock in every police station. We have special helplines. We have a special distress app, Himmat Plus. In addition to that...
It works? Himmat app works?
Yes, and now we have 112 also.
Okay.
So there is a shout out.
Ladies,
112 app
that.
Also.
Note it down. Yes.
112 shout out app also. So in addition to that, over a period of so many years, there have been a lot of gender sensitization programs, and I must tell you, they started way before the Nirbhaya case happened.
Okay.
So we had been working actively with the NGOs, mm-hmm. and we had been working at the ground, at the police station level with the NGOs, with lead
right.
NGO in each and every. So we have already done a lot. We have internal systems also in place in the form of sexual harassment workplace committees as well. Because as the number of women grows, we want to take care of that also and not perpetrate the, you know, the culture of silence there.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Saheli, one closing word from you. One closing comment.
Firstly, I do not believe in hurried justice. However, ma'am would also agree, there's time-bound justice that we need to really push for. And maybe if there's one thing more I could think of, that is just we have ED. We should have another maybe serious crimes against women unit
okay.
to look into these investigations. But leaving this platform on a positive note, just that we have fear which is contagious, so is courage. And
right.
probably that is the celebration of Shri Shakti today.
Absolutely. Wonderful words to conclude this conversation with. If fear is contagious, so is courage. So step up, speak up, because ultimately change has to be asked for. Thank you very much, Justice Malhotra, Suman Alva and Saheli Chakrabarty for this very insightful conversation. Thank you.